This presentation is offered to the greater glory of God in appreciation for the legacy of six generations of exemplary Western heritage, and also as a tribute to the memory of Barbara O'Malley, an extraordinary lady who made a difference. The story of Weston is an epic saga of history and heritage. Fortunately, many historians have conscientiously gleaned and chronicled all the important events. Our heritage is the product of extraordinary people and their encounters with triumphs over many tragedies. Our people implored God to grant them the wisdom to accept the things that they could not change, the courage to change the things they could, and the guidance to know the difference. We're going to pursue the elements responsible for Weston's rapid growth, her gradual demise, and glorious rebirth. We will study the community and the people, the location, their homes, churches, shops, and businesses. William Paxton introduced his 1897 Annals of Platte County with a single stanza. Our county records claim no heroes known to fame, no mystic legends old, no monuments are found, no ruins mar the ground, no minstrel tale is told. President Thomas Jefferson was a true visionary with regard for history, a keen sense of values and direction. He was responsible for the Louisiana Purchase, the Lewis and Clark Expedition, without which there would have been no Weston. In 1817, Jefferson wrote his longtime friend and neighbor, John Adams, observing that a morsel of genuine history is a thing so rare as to be always valuable. The people of Weston respected his judgment. Weston is a testimonial to his observation. Weston's history and heritage are cyclical, toggling between triumphs and tragedies. The oldest town in the Platte Purchase was an instant boomtown success. The proximity to Fort Leavenworth, rich Lewis soil, ideal port, and enterprising settlers made it the gateway to the West. It was the town furthest west in the United States trade. The population forged from 0 to 5,000. Weston was second only to St. Louis in activity and importance. Then, beginning with the war, the citizenry plummeted to less than 1,000. The Civil War, fires, floods, destruction of the port, loss to the railroad, typhoid, and Asiatic cholera took their toll. In Weston's National Register nomination papers, it was pointed out that from the aspect of historic preservation, it was indeed fortunate that the town had not been able to maintain its antebellum vitality. The true blessing was that the 1,000 who stayed cherished and nurtured the rich cultural heritage of their forefathers. We will examine the elements of that heritage to see what makes Weston so uniquely special. History is a recording of events. Heritage is a study of people's reactions and the effect of those events. Heritage is nebulous. It's attitude. You can't touch it. No one can ever take it from you. The same events may cause diametrically opposed reactions to any two people. Our pioneers suffered hardship and endured deprivations so that their lives could make a difference. That difference is our legacy. Their lives attest to Thomas Edison's contention that restless is discontent, and discontent is the first necessity of progress. There are three categories of history: what was written, what was said, and what was physically preserved. Archaeology, what was passed on, is the most objective. Our Weston legacy has been maintained as it was in history from 2,500 years ago. Weston offers three museums: Weston Historical Museum, Lewis and Clark Exhibit, and the Bunnell Farm Museum. Many history authors have referred to Weston as Queen of the Platte Purchase, Mid-America's most historic city, a town saved by destruction, the town that time forgot, the town that refused to die, town where a past is present. In The Grapes of Wrath, John Steinbeck asked, if we don't know our heritage, how can we know who we are? The dictionary defines heritage as an inheritance, something that is passed down from preceding generations. Heritage includes the treasure trove of values and the traditions which were cherished by our ancestors and appreciated enough today to be saved by our descendants of tomorrow. Our heritage is determined by our ancestors, associates, teachers, and mentors. It is tempered by our environs and the times in which we live. It is not the honor that we take with us, but the heritage that we leave behind that forms the perception of a society and its communities. Under the London Company Charter of 1606, Virginia's territory extended to the Mississippi River. By the 1803 Louisiana Purchase, the United States acquired 828,800 square miles of new territory. Our western boundary moved to include lands that are now Louisiana, Oklahoma, Kansas, Colorado, Wyoming, and Montana. The purchase price was $15 million. Still a bargain at $219 million in today's money. The new wilderness was set aside as the white man's appeasement of conscience to the Indians, who were pushed even further west when Missouri was added to the Union. Missouri's western boundary extended due north from the intersection of the Kansas and Missouri rivers. The fertile lands west to the Missouri River were the new Indian hunting grounds. The Platte Purchase Treaty was an 1836 land acquisition that added 3,149 square miles east along the Missouri River. The acquired area was nearly as large as the combined states of Delaware and Rhode Island. On March 28, 1837, President Martin Van Buren proclaimed the Platte Purchase part of the state of Missouri. Missouri was already the largest state by land area. William Clark presided over the ceremony at Fort Leavenworth. The Iowa, Sac, and Fox tribes were to receive $7,500 and some other usual promises. The town of Weston was the first established. It was so named as it was the outpost furthest west in the United States trade. The Missouri Compromise had permitted Missouri to enter the Union as a slave state. The settlers from Virginia, Kentucky, and Tennessee had been engaged in tobacco and cotton, both extremely labor-intensive crops. Slaves were the workhorses of those crops. It was hemp that replaced cotton in the Platte country. During the country's westward expansion, Fort Leavenworth was a forward destination for thousands of soldiers, surveyors, immigrants, American Indians, preachers, and settlers. The fort is the oldest active U.S. post west of Washington, D.C. It has been in operation for over 180 years. The proximity of the fort to Weston provided business for the local merchants and tradesmen. Location A at the top right is Weston. B marks the site of the steam ferry at Rialto. Those wishing to cross the river availed themselves to the ferry boat to convey them and their goods to the fort at C, at the lower end of Weston Bend. In 1856, John J. McNamara, an Episcopal clergyman, wrote a day-by-day account of the life in Weston. He reported,
"The quartermaster threw millions into the coffers of the traders at Weston and the farmers and stock raisers of its neighborhood. The streets and shops of the town, two or three times in the year, would be crowded with the various tribes of Indians who would have come to trade after receiving their payments. In addition to all of these means of gain, much of the overland trade into New Mexico, California, Salt Lake, and Oregon took its rise from here. The traders of Weston, in a word, did an immense business. I never saw in a town of 2,800 inhabitants in any state where money in gold and silver was so plenty, and where wealth was so general in the possession of the traders. Beside these circumstances, Weston had a character of men and measures peculiar even to Missouri."
The outreaches of Weston's port were defined by the bluff roads. They were studded with boarding houses and saloons. The military road began at the Riley House at what is now Welt Street. The Lynch House on the North Road is at the end of Washington Street. The port came in toward Water Street, now Market. A mooring ring was in the side of the Weston Chronicle building. That ring is now in the museum's side yard. The dock was a constant, round-the-clock beehive of activity. A lookout in the bell tower of the Presbyterian Church would ring the bell to announce a boat entering the port. That toll summoned draymen, stevedores, and warehousemen. Hemp, tobacco, corn, and apples were shipped all over the United States. The port of Weston, able to hold 5 steamers at a time, was second only to St. Louis in activity and importance. As many as 225 steamboats visited in a year. As compared to the open prairie, steamboat passengers' accommodations were quite comfortable. Passengers could choose a cabin or deck-only ticket. Many lines touted the security of howitzer on the bow to discourage any gentleman of the bush. You made good time. Boats traveled night and day. Downstream, you made 8 miles an hour. Upstream was the same as the average walking pace, 3 miles an hour. Rivers don't flow in a straight line. We calculate Weston to St. Louis on I-29 at 250 miles. By river, it is 506 miles. There were nearly 100 potential stops by steamers. Weston was the 6th stop beyond Parkville. Weston to Kansas City was an overnight trip. The overland journey from Weston to Oregon and California meant a 6-month trip across 2,000 miles of difficult country. It was an expensive undertaking. It was estimated that the journey cost a family about $1,000. In addition, they needed a specially outfitted wagon costing about $400. A canvas top had to be waterproofed with linseed oil and stretched over a framework of hoop slats. The wagons were packed with food, supplies, cooking equipment, and water kegs. The maximum load was 2,500 pounds. A typical family of 4 carried 800 pounds of flour, 200 of lard, 700 pounds of bacon, 200 pounds of beans, 100 of fruit, 75 pounds of coffee, and 25 pounds of salt. Only small children and older parents rode in the wagon. Others walked beside the slow-moving vehicle or rode on the back of a horse. In addition to her advantages of location, steamer, and wagon transportation, Weston's wind-blown soil and moderate climate made her ideally suited for most any crop. As back in their native Virginia, Kentucky, and Tennessee, our pioneers had a ready workforce and could engage in the most profitable, even if labor-intensive, harvests. Hemp and tobacco were extremely profitable. 40% of Weston's population was slave labor. Most of them lived in cabins at the northern edge of town. They were extremely valuable and treated as such. Many of our finest citizens are buried in Laurel Hill Cemetery. Many blacks are interred there as well. Hemp is one of the earliest domesticated and fastest growing biomasses known. It produces up to 25 tons of dry matter per 100 acres. Plants are grown close together and reach a height of 10 to 12 feet. The crop depends on conditions after harvest. Cut plants are clubbed, combed with a hackle, and left to rot in the field. The fibers were pressed into huge bales and transported to the rope walk. Generally, the fibers were twisted in the field. Weston had 3 one-quarter mile long covered walks. The resultant cordage was coiled and transported to the factories in St. Louis. There were 3 dozen drays licensed to transport coils to the waiting steamers in Weston. Each slave worker was expected to comb at least 9 pounds of hemp a day. A steady worker could do 20 pounds. Most of the cordage was intended for rigging on sailing ships. It was subject to rot when wet. The rope had to be tarred before use. Weston became the hemp capital of the world. Weather conditions during the winter determined the quality of the hemp crop. In 1860, Weston had a record harvest of nearly 20 tons. That record stood for over 150 years. The farmer received $200 to $300 per ton, but after 1875, cordage production had ceased. The labor force had moved, and less labor-intensive grain crops replaced hemp and tobacco. The stalk fiber of hemp is used for cordage. The leaves supply the recreational drug. This year, the Platte County Sheriff's Department was notified of a hemp crop in the vicinity of Kansas City International Airport. They reportedly burned close to $5 million worth of marijuana harvest, and the folks downwind seemed unusually contemplative. The manager of the Missouri ASCS office declared Weston soil to be comparable to that of the Nile Valley. It was reportedly very rich. The deep, rich earth is ideally suited to burley tobacco. From the 12 by 100-foot canvas-covered beds in March to the cadence of the auctioneer and the final processing into hogsheads the following January, Weston's Brown Gold attracted countless visitors to its annual auctions. Weston was the only tobacco auction west of the Mississippi. A quarter-ounce packet of seed would sow a bed and provide enough plants for 2 acres. An average 2-acre crop would yield over $9,000 at the local auction. But every cent had to be earned. The plants had to be set in the field, and they had to be topped to remove the suckers. At harvest, the leaves were gathered and tied into hands. The hands were strung onto stakes and hung on the rafters in the barn until they came into case. The leaves had to dry, yet absorb enough moisture so they could be handled. The cured hands were laid on baskets for inspection and grading. The average weight of a basket of tobacco was 500 to 600 pounds. Congress, with various agricultural programs, initially subsidized, then set regulated allotments on the amount a farmer could grow, and with health concerns, production was cut drastically. Weston's transportation industry was lost to the river-changing channels and the railroad. Her hemp and tobacco advantages suffered because of the loss of her workforce, which was brought on by the Civil War. She did enjoy a real advantage with her apple orchards, a brewery, and distillery. All of these were well regarded in this country as well as in Europe. The Shawhand Applejack Distillery was on Water Street, and the warehouse set behind. Perry's Mill was on the Leavenworth Bluff Road. The brewery and distillery were in the same locations as today. Family life in early Weston was punctuated by some lighter moments. We would think of it as work, but they considered these to be leisure. The primary recreation was conversation. We have all heard of spelling bees. Actually, there was a bee for almost everything that might involve a gathering where friends and neighbors joined together in a single activity. The term bee might come from the Middle English word bine, which means a prayer or a favor. In England, the dialect form of this word, B-E-E-N or B-E-A-N, referred to voluntary help given by neighbors toward the accomplishment of a particular task. The men had ice cutting, slaughtering, and barn raising. Their concept was almost communistic. Everyone did what he could for those with any need. Each was, in his own way, his brother's keeper. That was the basis of Weston heritage. The ladies had spinning bees, quilting, husking, and such. There are references to spinning bees back to the mid-1700s. Bees were an opportunity to visit with others with similar interests. The children had spelling bees. They played Hucklebuckle Beanstalk, Fox and Jeeves, and Mary Mac. They had competitions involving the solution of a puzzle. The rebus was a popular form of picture puzzle. The vernacular of the times is quite different. We'll give you a couple of clues. The spit held a joint of meat or fowl above the fire. The disc-like bowl in the center is a spittoon, and the military gentleman was General Butts. Therefore,
the gentlemen are requested to spit in the spittoon, and not on the floor, and to throw their butts and stumps in the stove or out at the window.
Stevedores, draymen, and warehousemen, and other laborers conversed in one of the many saloons. Ben Holliday had a popular spot near the wharf. He purchased whiskey by the barrel for 25 cents a gallon and sold it for 25 cents a shot. Frank Kelly's in the hotel was the gathering place for politicians, professionals, tradesmen, and traveling salesmen. Frank purchased all of the remaining stock of the distillery when David Holliday died. He found a vintage bottle of the brewery's Pilsner in a well, and he kept it in his safe for many years. Watch for it on eBay. Some of Weston's most ardent promoters were members of our Masonic Lodge. As a group, they served as guardians of our heritage. The Weston Lodge was chartered in October of 1842. Their records have faithfully portrayed what had transpired. The lodge suffered considerable damage as a result of fires in 1855, 1859, and 1884. They were among the first in the restoration of their building. Community meetings are conducted on the ground floor, and regular lodge meetings and ceremonies take place on the second floor. The Preserve America Driving Tour and CD provides a map identifying 89 historically significant locations. These are available at the museum, chamber, and city hall. Churches serve as the conscience of the community and greatly influence the bounds of mores and taboos of our heritage. Besides the spirituality of the congregation, they figure greatly in leisure entertainment. Our churches have sponsored Sunday schools, Bible classes, socials, picnics, revivals, and chautauquas. Weston has six churches organized before the Civil War. The Methodist Church, diagonal from the chamber, commenced building in 1859. Work was suspended during the Civil War and was completed in 1867. You can see what a feat this was if you will look up the backside to the third floor sanctuary. Pleasant Ridge Church is at the other end of the spectrum. The church, cemetery, and college were the work of Jesse and John Vineyard. Reverend Robert James preached here in February 1844. You might have heard of a couple of his boys, Frank and Jesse James. J.C. Penney was an 1859 graduate of the college. His son, J.C., had a chain of clothing and department stores throughout the country. President Lincoln's first love, Mary Owens Vineyard, is laid to rest in the churchyard cemetery. Your family can enjoy five of Weston's well-maintained parks. City Park is behind the Methodist Church. Weston Bend is on South Highway 45. It offers everything from a 1,133-acre vantage point above the river to complete campgrounds. Weston Red Barn Farm features traditional farm animals and crops. They offer school tours, a country store, and facilities for weddings and bonfire hayride events. They are open spring through fall. Snow Creek has a 10,000-square-foot ski lodge with bar and lounge, cafeteria, rental shop, and lessons center. There are complete ski, snowboard, and tube park facilities. 60 snowmaking machines provide 12 inches of snow in a 24-hour period. Weston is family entertainment at its best, something special 365 days a year. Traveling Highway JJ, in or out of town, you will pass McCormick Distillery. Ben and his brother David started the Holiday Distillery here in 1856. It is one of only two distilleries in the nation to be listed on the National Register of Historic Places. In the early 1900s, there were some investors who were financially active in both the brewery and the distillery. Be sure to stop at the McCormick Country Store at 4020 Main Street. Their complete line is available, as well as fine souvenir items. While you're trying to satiate your thirst, you should make a sojourn to Pirtle's Winery across from the brewery on Spring Street. These two have had a long relationship. The old German church was at one time used as a bottling facility for the brewery. The church, brewery, and winery might seem incompatible. However, their missions were not concurrent. Consider this. Pliny the Elder averred that in wine there is truth, and our own Benjamin Franklin offered the opinion that beer is proof that God loves us and wants us to be happy. Weston's ultimate tragedy and resultant suffering came with the Civil War. The slavery question had been brewing since the Missouri Compromise of 1820. The local unrest began before Fort Sumter and hung on after Appomattox. Missouri provided a full quota, 3,000 troops to each side, as Missouri was both Union and Confederate. There were no major battles, no great loss of lives. The only recorded battle was at Bee Creek Bridge. The hour-long skirmish had 4 Federals killed, 7 wounded. Confederates suffered 1 killed, 1 wounded. The real casualties were the result of border raids of the Quantrell, James, and Younger brothers, Bushwhackers of Missouri, and the Kansas Jayhawkers led by Lane and Jennison. Hundreds of people were killed annually as far back as the mid-50s. Neither local persuasion won the war. Both sides were our people. Everyone lost. Weston lost 80% of her population. Land values plummeted. The people who remained had to adjust to an entirely new lifestyle. Lincoln got 105 of the vote in 1860. He got one half as many as McClellan in 1864. The news of the president's assassination was received with great sadness in Weston. April 18th was set aside as a special day of mourning. A city council resolution was passed unanimously, paying tribute to Lincoln. The Negroes were free.
Good news, chariots are coming, good news.
They had been loyal to their owners, and the owners had been protective. Many Negroes stayed without pay. There had always been a good relationship with the Negro workforce. The owners had provided a place to live and food for the table. They built the Bethune School for education for their children. There was only one reported incident of an ugly KKK cross burning. Everyone seemed to know who was involved, but no one ever spoke of it. Paxton lamented his allegation that Weston had no heroes known to fame. He made a premature judgment. In retrospect, our greatest heroes were those who stayed with the town after she had lost her transportation supremacy and her agricultural advantages. The 20% who stayed were the loyal conservators of our heritage and guardians of our homes, shops, and churches, which we appreciate today. Most of our historically significant events and sites are identified with signs and markers. This one should have been added. For almost 100 years, nothing happened. The people maintained the status quo. Weston's meteoric rise to prominence took little more than a dozen years. Then everything came to a halt. Little town slipped into a somnambulistic state. The townspeople appreciated and cherished what they had. However, they were unable to make any advances. The greatest assets were the churches, homes, businesses, and shops. This they decided to share with others. To complement the 1960 opening of the Weston Historical Museum, they opened 5 of their homes on the prestigious Spring Street Hill. Spring Street begins on the east, at the brewery and the winery. The museum is on Main. The homes selected were representative of the sizes, ages, and architectural styles of the community. The open house was so successful that it has been done regularly ever since. The Price Loyal's home, built in 1857, was the home of descendants of Daniel Boone and General Robert E. Lee. 5 generations of the Boone-Lee Price descendants occupied this Federal-style cottage. Look to the right past the Loyal's house, and you will think that you are on one of the narrow lanes at Old Salem or Colonial Williamsburg. 4 of the homes on the short, dead-end street have been determined historically significant. Woodbine, on the corner, was built in 1844. A glance at the front corner will give you a clue of the stages of construction. The south wall started out of stone. The addition is clapboard. The mistress of the Bless Home was the soul of Weston and the primary reason you are interested. Bertha Blessed was raised by her uncle, August Walruff. August served several terms as mayor and was the owner of the Weston Brewery. Bertha was the editor of the Weston Chronicle newspaper. She was the prime mover of Weston's historical preservation. She was the personification of Weston heritage. George and Mary Warner Hulse built this home in 1843. They got into considerable trouble by allowing an abolitionist minister to teach slaves to read in their home. Hulse and the minister were forced to leave town. Following the war, the family freed their slaves and returned to Weston. The fifth home of the tour was built by Lorenzo Byrd in 1847. It was built as a 1 1/2-story federal style. The roof line was later changed to Dutch colonial. The dry-laid rock wall is still in excellent condition. These five homes were on the first 1960s tour. Over 100 other sites are of great interest. Each one tells its own story. Homes are open on special occasions, and groups may arrange private tours through the Weston Historical Museum. Going up the hill, the intersections of Edward, Prospect, Spring Annex, Summit, and Back Street had significant homes. The pavement, curbs, gutters, and sidewalks were still on the to-do list when these photographs were taken for the National Register nomination in 1971. There are not too many things older than dirt. However, I don't think that there was any particular historical value to maintain the original 134-year-old dirt. There were simply other priorities. The most ardent purist would not care to live as our grandparents did. We are used to indoor plumbing. We have closets, we have utility rooms for heat, central air, and electricity. We have gotten used to hot water in the tap. We don't all sleep in the same room. We have dens, nurseries, sewing rooms, and laundry facilities. The challenge comes when you try to add these amenities to a 150-year-old home. We must maintain the integrity as we increase the utility. The Eskridge home was built in 1856. There is virtually no space between the homes on either side. Without compromising the aesthetics, this owner expanded the 1,100-square-foot cottage to 2,700 square feet. A solarium was added to the back, all of the space you could want without sacrificing the appearance from the street. Mary Owen's vineyard was referred to as Lincoln's other Mary. He courted her and then proposed to her in 1836. She declined, thinking him deficient in the social graces. Her Walnut Street home has one of the finest dry-laid rock walls in Weston. This house, situated on a steep hill, had no space for any serviceable side addition. Subsequent owners have added to the rear. Both additions have been very straightforward, with no pretense of being part of the original. Buffalo Bill's uncle, Elijah Cody, was the first to hold the deed to this four-lot parcel on Market Street. The three-room dwelling on the right was built in 1849. The home was renovated in 1990. A very well-done addition was added on the left, set back from the original structure. Everything is entirely compatible. Change is inevitable. The challenge is always to maintain the integrity of the property. You can't build old. However, with some thought and patience, you can have changes that complement the original. A bit of paint and landscaping makes a world of difference on this Victorian gem. This is now one of Weston's charming bed and breakfasts. Harry Truman spent the night here when he was a senator in 1936. His bedroom is now the dining room. The renovation and the addition was one of the first magnitude in Weston. The entire three-story right side was added in 2005, everything from the right terminus of the wraparound porch all the way up. Phil Grimm lived in this home across from the brewery when he served as superintendent. The property is now the Hatchery Bed and Breakfast. The property was offered for sale in the 1980s for $35,000. Many of Weston's building lots sold for $25. Some owners purchased two lots side by side. Nathan Ogden was an owner of the brewery. His Spring Street home on the hill to the northwest of the brewery was purchased with a $475 loan. Built in the 1840s, this walnut log cabin sold at a city hall tax sale for $13. The big problem, I suppose, was that you had to have cash. Built in 1851, this brick home and 240-foot-wide lot cost $480. It sold in 1879 for $280. The widow owner bequeathed it to the Christian Church in 1933. Glass entryway window memorialized the donors with their thoughtful generosity. The impetus given by the National Register designation was all that was needed to encourage the reclamation of Weston's early prominence. There wasn't any way to resurrect the wagon trains and steamboats. Hemp was outlawed and tobacco was highly regulated. The Weston Brewery had been the largest manufacturing enterprise in Platte County. It was 10 years senior to Anheuser-Busch and had advertised as the oldest brewery west of the Hudson. The old stone cellars were in excellent condition. The brewery seemed the logical place to start a return to fame. Brewing principles had not changed for over 6,000 years. Equipment was radically improved. There was no need to cellar the beer. There wasn't any way to thread the oak casks through the shaft to the lower cellars. Modern equipment is stainless, and the temperature is maintained by glycol-jacketed tanks. The new equipment was set up in front of the pit log hold stone walls of the original brewery. The arched stone, 40, 50, and 60 feet deep, would be put to better use. The brewery was always a community endeavor. Everyone was proud of it. The beer was shipped all over the country and in Europe. Brewery personnel were community leaders. The founder, Johannes Georgens, was elected to serve on the board of aldermen. Later, owner, August Walruff, served several terms as mayor. Townsfolk gathered on Sunday for a shower bath under the steam outlet above the boiler. Sweet Charlie watered the streets to keep the dust down. On occasion, they would abuse the residents by such as the display of a bouquet of roses frozen in a block of ice. Street lighting was provided by the brewery dynamo. Merchants were invited to tap onto the brewery water line going up Main Street. Locals could purchase a pint of beer or 25 pounds of ice for a dime. The brewery sponsored the first KC Royals baseball team. They rewarded volunteer firemen with a keg at Kelly's following a fire. The original brewery headquarters, plant, and cellars were located at Cross and Welt Streets in Weston. There was a warehouse at 15th and Hickory in Kansas City and a branch office at 1912 Grant Avenue. A distribution center was established at 3rd and Shawnee in Leavenworth. Following Prohibition and the latter reopening, things changed considerably. All operations were consolidated in Weston. In addition to the brewery, the complex added a restaurant, Irish pub, beer garden, and bed and breakfast inn. Approximately 20% of the 1842 brewery letterhead was used to announce their three beers. Royal Pilsner, advertised as the beer that made Milwaukee jealous, Rip Van Winkle, the richest bottle of beer in the world, and Vivitone, a family beverage for all ailments. Today, the brewery produces a much broader selection. In addition to their regular rotation, they have seasonal offerings to do contract brewing. Their capacity is 20,000 barrels. They won a gold medal in this year's competition. Over the years, the brewery has issued many souvenir items, bar trays, ceramic mugs, sample glasses, and a set of connoisseur postcards, which published prices. This card was printed in Germany at the close of the 19th century. Prices are subject to change. The 24 quarts are no longer available at $3.75 per case. The historic brewery was reopened to attract tourists. You cannot invite busloads of visitors to tour your homes, churches, shops, and museums without providing a place to relax and enjoy a meal. The keeping room is where the family kept for meals and fellowship. It was where they entertained relatives and friends. The America Bowman keeping room is an incongruous maze of four rooms, an umbrellaed table, patio, and a lanai, all connected by a labyrinth of halls, passages, and a tunnel. Brewery founder Johannes Georgens' portrait hangs on the bittersweet front wall over the 19th century quarter-sawn red oak Weston Post Office fixtures in the ordinary. This traditional dining room chronicles the family's heritage and displays a multitude of public house artifacts, including an antique sherry tun and two small poutine stills. The entertainment complex is a favorite for groups of all sizes. Private rooms are available to make any special occasion truly special. You and your group are invited to take the 26 steps down to the brewery cellar and enjoy your favorite victuals and libations, where politicians, river captains, wagon masters, draymen, and stevedores met 170 years ago. Politics and beer always seemed to go well together. The topics of conversation would have been the ascension of Victoria to the throne of England and the election of John Tyler to be the 10th President of the United States. A message from the White House to New York took 9 hours. A message from the White House to Weston would have taken much longer. Today, the arch brick walls are covered with period games, prints, signs, and local historical memorabilia. Early shop-style lamps hang over the hand-hewn tables, flanked by settles and church pew benches. The restaurant is open daily from 11:30 to 9 p.m. Everything is homemade and prepared to order. Special menus are available for private parties. You can design your own cocktail buffet, host a patio pig roast, partake of an old-world banquet, and delight your group with high tea. America Bowman is big enough to accommodate a group of 300, yet small enough to do it right. It is a great place to punctuate your Weston visit. Modern brewing equipment dispenses with the need for the cool, 20-foot-high arch stone cellars. They were quite a marvel in 1842. They had to be preserved. If you have a historical brewery, you need a venue suited to the relaxation with a pint. Why not an Irish pub? The Irish take issue with the allegation that they drink a lot. They contend they just drink often. This cellar provides tri-level seating surrounding the entertainers. Buffets, banquets, and sit-down pub grub are served with your favorite libations and are available for groups in this pub cellar. O'Malley and Son has been a Weston tradition for many years. In addition to the regular entertainment, there are a number of special festivals and celebrations that draw as many as 10 times our normal population. During the Weston Irish Festival, pipers and step dancers join in to provide a truly memorable experience. There are 4 stages of internationally famous entertainers. The opening of the Platte Country and Weston brought an immediate influx in the need for short-term lodging. The newcomers had to have a place to stay. In order to meet the need, boarding houses sprang up on Water Street and the bluff roads surrounding the port. The St. George Hotel was built in 1845. The southwest portion of the brewery property has 2 stone cellars and the old ice house. Following Prohibition, these had been covered by a wooden structure used to house tobacco. The tobacco barn burned in the mid-70s. Rather than filling in the excavation with dirt, the owners decided to save the cellars and cover them with the inn at Weston Landing. In recognition of the fact that so many early settlers came from the British Isles, the Celtic-style inn has an English, Scottish, Welsh, and Irish room. A 4-page spread in Missouri Life magazine announced the opening of the inn at Weston Landing, which marks the latest chapter in the history of the oldest brewery west of the Hudson. The extremely high-pitched roof, low-set dormers, parapeted gables, and irregular masonry constructions depict a definite Celtic rural British Isles influence, a bit of a paradox of what we expect to see in an 1837 Missouri River town. The Andrew O'Malley Room is indicative of the typically distinctive accommodations. It is billed as a lesson in Irish history at the time of the Great Famine. A common roof and Celtic heritage are the only similarities in the inn's quarters and the distinctive cultures they represent. The variations are demonstrated in the range from the quintessential simplicity of the O'Malley cabin to Victorian England's warm elegance as portrayed in the bedchamber of Trevor Chadwick. The Rose and Fleming Scottish room and the Welsh Squire David Tenby rooms are equally delightful. The Weston Chamber of Commerce and website provide complete information on all of Weston's B&Bs and the St. George Hotel. Ingram's Magazine voted Weston number one best day trip. Visit KC.com voted Weston best overnight destination. It has been 40 years since the Weston Historic District was entered in the National Register of Historic Places. It is a town where the past is truly present. Weston has returned to glory. It is a glory entirely different from the days of steamers and wagon trains. It is even more vibrant. My Gazetteer lists 23 Westons. There really is only one. We are not on your way to anywhere. You have to want to come see us. Bring the family and enjoy Mid-America's most historic city. Thanks be to God for the bounty of His blessings continuously bestowed on Weston. Thanks to the 20% of her people who did not despair and desert her. Thanks for their perseverance. These could have been the subjects of Sir Walter Scott's poem, My Native Land. These Westonians were the epitome of the powerful, innate force within us to proudly voice an appreciation for their homeland, preserve its heritage, and proclaim, "This is my own, my native land. Weston is not a utopia." Just as Scott had his wretch considered all in self, Weston has an occasional self-anointed, important person. With God's continued help, the extraordinary, ordinary people will prevail. Special thanks to the Weston Historical Museum, the Weston Development Company, the Weston Chamber of Commerce, and selfless volunteers, and the Bank of Weston for their community-mindedness. Thanks to Barbara O'Malley, who sacrificed a normal life to help Weston become re-energized and take advantage of its recognition by the National Register of Historic Places. Barbara made a difference. She chose Weston over her great-great-great-great-grandfather's 1758 home in Gaston, North Carolina, and her husband's great-grandfather's pre-Civil War home in Lexington, Missouri. She was the restorer of an 1842 Weston business and 1851 home. She provided victuals, libations, crack, music, song, and lodging to attract and entertain hundreds of thousands of appreciative visitors. She conceived a program and marketed Weston to tour companies, associations, clubs, and organizations. She worked to have Weston recognized as a national treasure and share its ubiquitous heritage. She served as museum, WDC, and Chamber Historic Homes Tour hostess. She was the founder of the Friends of the Weston Historical Museum. She was a founding underwriter of the Weston Development Company. She served as a member of the board of the Weston Historical Museum. She was president of the West Platte PTA. Barbara accepted the challenge of the Daughters of the American Revolution theme: preserve the past, enhance the present, and invest in the future.